you like to meet somebody who, at 12 years of age, finished their formal education, later joined the Merchant Navy, and in doing so saw the aftermath of Hiroshima, travelled the Suez Canal, met Che Guevara in Cuba, met many of America's and New York's famous film stars, Dick Frank Sinatra, Tony Bennett, and some of its top gangsters as well. How about Lucky Luigiano and Frank Costello? That man also has a book written about him as well. With me in conversation today is the one and only John Clancy. Good afternoon, John.
Thank you very much.
Great to meet you at
Thanks
last.
Thanks for coming.
And can I say, John, that that is only the tip of the iceberg of your life to now.
Yeah, well, everybody can write a book, you know what I mean? Yeah, and whatever you're going to hear is the truth. I may not be able to put it together because, like you people who went to college and all of that. But, yeah, I've seen a lot of the world. I wanted to see all the world, and I have seen it. Now I'm here in the Slievost Hotel, and I booked in for 6 weeks, and I'm travelling around. How am I travelling? I'm travelling on the bus. It's free travel. And when a cabin man gets a chance, I'm travelling free. So I travel all around, come to meet the family, and I'm going around the country.
So let's get back to John Clancy, where he came from. John, you're in your 80s at this stage. And may I say something I didn't mention in the introduction there as well, that you have been for 70 years a total pioneer.
That's right, yeah. I went to the tech in Vaughan Boy, but that was the workhouse. And when somebody mentioned in New York, were you in the workhouse? They thought it was the poorhouse. No, it was that's where we were educated at that time.
But we said in the introduction that you finished school at 12,
and
we were speaking earlier, and you said, and it is part of our Irish, it is part of our heritage, or it is part of our history here. You said that your two teachers in particular were brutal to you.
Very brutal, very brutal. And it was very brutal. We didn't learn anything. They used a stick.
You learned fear.
If you do anything wrong, you get 6 slaps.
Yeah.
So I turned against the teachers. I didn't like the teachers at all.
So there was no point, and it didn't instill love of education into that stage. But having said that, you grew up, your father had a public house, and that's where you saw your first, that's where you grew up, that's where you saw your dad work a public house in Ballyconnell.
That's right. In Ballyconnell, it was, nobody had that in that time. 1947 was the biggest snow. And I heard my grandfather saying, when in 1948, I wouldn't like to be starting a family at Ballyconnell. In 1954, my father said, I wouldn't like to be starting a family. So when do you start a family? So grandfather owned the mill in Ballyconnell. That's when his brother brought the GEA to Ballyconnell.
The first Ulster medalist. That's a great history to have, isn't it? Yes. So you grew up there in your formal home, and then you told me the nice story where you were sent off to be an apprentice carpenter, but due to the political unrest at the time, you weren't allowed to work in the north because you were an Irish Catholic, and you didn't get a permit in doing so.
You had to be a permit to permit to stay in Ballyconnell and to stay in Northern Ireland. And you got a form to fill in and you sent away, and if the permit came back you could stay, if the permit didn't come back you didn't stay. So I took the tools, the saw and a hammer and a few tools, and I threw them in the back of the bar. I said I'll never use the tool again, never I did.
Okay, but it didn't end there. Thanks be to goodness it didn't end there. Not a man to do nothing. I think it was your dad then decided that you perhaps could go to London to learn the trade.
That's right.
And he gave you the fare to go to London and learn your trade.
Yeah, to work in the bar, the seventh time in the bar. That time you had to pay £15 if you were sent to Dublin. You had to pay the owner of the bar £15 to train you. And first you had to pay accommodation, all of that. They got cheap labour, but that was the system at that time. You had to serve your time for 3 years in a bar in Dublin to be a barman.
But it showed you that at that young age, leaving home at that young age, that you had the willingness, you wanted to do it, you wanted to get on. But of course you were too young then to be a bar person.
I was too young then. When I went to my father said, go and see Mr. Gillen in the Red Lion in Kilburn and he will train you in. So I went in, went there, and he said, how old are you? 16. Well, you can't go behind the bar till you're 18. You're not allowed to go behind the bar. So I got all the dirty jobs, cleaning up, walking the dogs and all that for a year until I joined the ship.
Yeah, that's when you got to the Merchant Navy, and then perhaps your life took really some really interesting turns there. As I said earlier, you travelled the Suez Canal, you got to meet Che Guevara in Cuba, all on your travels in the Merchant Navy. How long were you in the Navy at that time?
Around almost 10 years.
And you've seen, you named off the countries before that. You've been to Australia.
We went round the world. We went, the first trip I'd done was bringing immigrants to Australia. If you're living in England, Northern Ireland, for £11 at that time, you could go on the immigrant ship and they got you a job and et cetera, in Australia. So I'd done two trips to there, and then I joined the cruise ship, was cruising around the world. Mm-hmm. And then I worked on the Queen Elizabeth for 2 years. And then I was back on the world cruise.
What role were you on the ship?
I was a waiter on the ship.
Okay. So you were basically learning your trade that followed through in the rest of your life. You learned it there.
Yeah, American Express, they booked the ship for the world cruise. So I got involved on the tours, doing the tours, helping the American Express Tour Club for about 3 years. We went to every country in the world. They couldn't hardly mention Norway, Sweden, Denmark, Hiroshima, all over.
Amazing.
Even and, Ireland.
One. And then after 10 years, you decided to retire from that.
I gave it up then, and I came to work in New York. And everybody wanted, all the big restaurants wanted people who worked on the ships because they had great knowledge of the different foods of the different countries and all of that.
Okay.
If you're a barman coming out from Ireland, well, they didn't know much about food as such, but we did. I have worked in the most famous bar known in America at that time, famous for his name. I'm not saying it was greatest for food around, but the famous was Two Chores, beside the 21 Club.
That's where you met all the film stars.
That's where we met all the film stars there. And all the Kennedys and you name it, because it was beside all the theatres at that time.
Mm.
And that's where the man that wrote the book about The Godfather, I knew him very well. He spent a long time, and he had to hand over the book to the gangsters to read it before they'd allow him to make the film.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how long then, John, was your period, just to get your story? So you started working your way up through the in the food system there. How long was it from then until you bought your first premises? Or did you buy a premise in New York, or did you come back to Ireland? Just fill us in on the story.
I owned the bar in Ballyconnell. This surprised a lot of people. I owned the Clancy's Bar in Ballyconnell, an old bar with 10 rooms. And a big garden. In 1957, I sold it for £1,500. And then when I came back from America and I bought the Wooden Bridge Hotel in Wicklow. I bought it for $17,000. And I sold it. Somebody told me, there's a lovely little bar. Why don't you come back to Kevin? There's a lovely little bar for sale. And there's three places for sale. The Seven Horseshoes now is for sale that time.
Yeah.
And the Ulster Arms was for sale as well. And the Derry Garra.
So was the Derry Garra a little old thatched cottage at that stage, or did you?
No, I thatched it later on. No, it wasn't. It was started off for Harry O'Connell, an engineer of the County Council. He started it off, and then I came along. I added to it, and then I had an idea for people going up and down. All they have to do is to try to stop them because they went by so fast. So I done several different gimmicks. I had the donkey cart on the roof. And
they're not real donkey cart now.
They were concrete
ones. And they were just a miniature painting up in the thing. And that slowed people down in itself to have a look and see, didn't it?
That's right. Well, that time you see that there's a big road going by now. At that time, you had to go by Winter Street. You were going to Skilland if you were going to, from north to south. You were going to Donegal.
It was a main road,
all the coaches and all the politicians and everybody called in the Derry Garra at that time because there was food served all day.
Yeah, you were telling me earlier as well the amazing story of how you built up your food business, that nobody else was doing, that people could actually travel all the way from Dublin to Cavan and there'd be nowhere to stop off. You would just get bar food, which would be a soup and a sandwich. But you had the idea of giving them...
You had the headquarters held in a lot of other places. They'd done lunch and dinner. Maybe they'd done breakfast too, but in the afternoon at 4 o'clock, at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, all the beef would be a ham sandwich or a beef sandwich. But I started to do food all day from the time we opened until we closed. And it was very well known at that time.
Yeah.
People would drive by and say, look, I know the Dairy Garden. They may have never been in there in their life. But
brings me to 1976, and you got a national award.
1976, there was a bar food competition. Guinness and German, all those big companies come together and had a bar food competition. 133 bars entered it, from Mayo, Galway, you name it, Dublin, all over. And we entered it, and it was, I think there were 7 or 8 inspections. People come down and inspect it for service. Now, the black and white is a different thing. That's just for service of food. But this was for cleanliness, service, etc., etc., etc. And we had the flowers on the wall outside, flowers here and there, and the ants used to come and pick the flowers. I had a big sign outside, please don't touch the flowers. They're spread with a big long word, and they didn't know where it was near the dye. So the ants would say, don't touch that.
Well, a long story short, won the national award in 1976, and that perhaps started the famous name of the Dairy Garry. And not only you became famous in Cavan, but nationwide as well. If you mention the name Dairy Garry, and now can I even say now, even today, I know your interest in that has changed. But even today in America, New York, to some people, if you say the Dairy Garry in Cavan, it's famous. People, that's when it was started. That's how you started, put it on the mark, wasn't it?
People come in and we often had 3 or 4 coaches pull up at the same time, and then we had it became famous. But we made sure that the food was simple and served fast. It didn't lay around, you know.
And during this time, John, actually, you were becoming a little bit, if I may say so, you were becoming a little bit of a celebrity yourself. People were
No, my son is, not me.
No, at the time of the Dairy, you were featured on lots of TV programs nationwide. Yeah.
The Late Late Show.
The Late Late Show. But
like you here, I looked after the cameraman. And the cameraman used to come in from the Late Late Show, and I'd say, don't forget. And when I would be brought to the Late Late Show many times, they'd say, wait, John, wait at the back, until everybody sit down. And I'd walk down and they'd have the camera on me. But Gay Bourne wouldn't know what this was going on. Gay and I was very, very... But Gay Bourne's wife was the first person I borrowed from it. She came in with a dog on her arm. And Vincent Fitzpatrick, which is still in Butters Bridge, said, there's a lady inside with a dog in her arm. Tell her to get the hell out. But I can't, she's Gay Bourne's wife. Well, leave it to me. Who's Gay Bourne? Oh, that's the fellow on the Late Late Show. So I said, I'm very sorry. We don't allow anybody to bring dogs into the restaurant. So she went up, she got out to have a house in Donegal. She was very upset to come out. But later on, we became very, very good friends. But she was the first person. She talked because she was Gay's wife, she couldn't be a dog.
But you put her in her place anyway.
And yeah.
Okay, so then John, after a very successful time in the Dairy Garry, but you decided to move on.
Yeah, I decided, first of all, they were putting in a bypass. Eventually they're going to put a bypass in Butler's Ridge. And then, in the meantime, I had to get a bypass. I got a bypass myself. And the doctor is dead now, and Dr. Tony told me, my advice for you is to get it. You were involved in too many things, both faulty here and you're involved in such a thing.
So you went get to
get out and bought a bar down in Dungarvan. Mm. And then after that, then I had another heart attack. So I was in hospital for quite a while, and I got out and I said to my son, I'm going to go back to New York. This you made very hard to get, very hard to believe, so does everybody. But I left Dungarvan, and my daughters had sweets and books and chocolates to give to my son in America. And I took the case and I threw it in the river. And I said, I'm going to start from the very beginning again. And I went back to New York with the clothes I had on me, exactly the clothes and a raincoat, and that's very hard. And I started off, well, I had money in New York. But I started from scratch again.
Amazing.
And that's how...
So then that's how Foley's Bar came about then.
The one?
Foley's Bar.
Foley's Bar. Foley was a very, very famous... he was like Jimmy McGee. That was another good friend of mine in Ireland. Jimmy McGee, Foley was a very famous man on television and all. And he brought my son around and introduced him to baseball. And now he's a fanatic in baseball. He goes all over America, and he's very well known.
And that, of course, is Sean Clancy.
Sean Clancy.
Sean Clancy. And we'd just like to say there, we can put it on screen there, Foley's New York Pub and Restaurant. And it's an Irish bar with a baseball attitude, isn't that right?
That's
and
right.
It's on 18th West 33rd Street, New York.
That's right.
And as you said earlier on, everybody from Cavan, from Ireland, is welcome there.
That's right, everybody's welcome. Well, years ago when I went, 11, 14 years ago, there was a whole lot of bars in New York and all the owners were there, but there's no owners anymore. So if anybody lose their wallet or anybody lose their passport, they come to Foley's because they know that we have the connections with different people to get them, help them out. And that's all I do. I sit there inside and the people come from all over. Some of the richest people in New York comes in and sits down and chat with me in baseball now. I wouldn't know much about them, but and some of the poorest, and some of the anybody that comes out from Cavan, are going to be too delighted, especially from Cavan. As you can see, I have Cavan here, come out and be able to help them out, have a chat with them and talk about things at home.
Okay, so John, of an evening when you're sitting down and you reside in New York, you like to come over to Ireland every now and again because you some members of your family are here, your daughter and your grandchildren are here, and you like to come over and spend some time with them, but you do reside in New York.
I do,
most of the time. But when you're sitting there on an evening of your own and you look back over your life, your 83 years of life, and you think of the ups and downs and your amazing story there of how you started again. You went with no suitcase back over to New York after you had been through all your life here. And if I said to you, John, what is your secret of life? Would you tell me what is the secret of life? What made your life turn out so good? What was it? What is it about?
Never say you can't. If anybody said to me, you can't, they said to me the other day, you won't get down into the place in Lisses Key, what do you call it? The place, the restaurant, the Tatch in Lisses Key. There's a very famous restaurant.
I rang up
and I said, I'm staying at the Seabrook Hotel, I'm a tour guide, which I was a tour guide in New York. I said, my heels are up. So I went down the shore, but there's other people who were down in front of me and they couldn't get in. So you have to kind of bluff your way, you know what I mean?
So you're and if young people out there, if many young people out there are at a crossroads in their life and they'd like, I'd really want to do something with my life, would your message be simply to them, say, never say I can't?
Never say you can't. Well, a typical example of a man that I watched all through his life, met him many, many times, knew his father and mother well, was the man Sean Quinn. He was an example to all the people of what you can do from dark, you know. And now I'm staying in the hotel. Of course, I told him in America I couldn't stay in the penthouse, you know. So somebody rang the other day, yesterday morning, and said, Mr. Clancy is in the penthouse, can you put me through? The fellow said, what the hell are you talking about? So anyway, that's what life's all about.
See, that's where the bluffing comes in again. John Clancy, we spent a most fascinating afternoon with you. You were so interesting. We could go on here until the 1st of September, actually, but we can't. Thank you once again, John. We wish you the very best and a safe trip back to New York. And thank you for telling your stories. What a fascinating evening, folks. Fascinating stories from John Clancy, an amazing man, 83 years of age, and he's got lots of life and fun left in him. Thank you, John, for talking to us on Cavan TV.
You're very, very welcome.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.